First of all, I'd like to welcome you all. This is all a forced meeting, and I'm confident this will be the best one yet. I will have to make a few technical organizational announcements before lunch, and right now I want to jump the meeting in the middle of things and make a few remarks about the crazy world in which we live and the role of the property and freedom society. We live in the age of the American empire, and while it looks like this empire may be crumbling, for the foreseeable future it will certainly last, not only because of its military might, but more importantly because of its ideological power. For the American empire has accomplished something truly remarkable, that is, that its core beliefs are internalized in the minds of most people as some sort of intellectual taboos. To be sure, all governments rest on aggressive violence, and the United States government is no exception. It too does not hesitate to crush anyone resisting its legislative whims. However, the United States government needs astonishingly little actual violence to achieve submission to its commands, because the overwhelming majority of the population, and in particular of the opinion-molding intellectuals, has adopted the value and belief system that underlies the American system as its very normal belief system. Now, what is this belief system? According to the official United States approved belief system, we are all intelligent and reasonable people confronted with the same hard reality and committed to the same facts and the truth. True enough, even at the center of the American empire in the United States, people do not live in the best possible worlds. There are still some defects that need to be fixed. However, with the American system of democratic government, mankind has definitely found the perfect institutional framework allowing for continuous progress on the way toward an ever more perfect world. And if only the American system of democracy is adopted on a worldwide scale, the path to perfection is everywhere clear and open. The only truly legitimate form of government is democracy. Any other form of government is inferior. There exist monarchies, dictatorships, and theocracies, and there exist feudal lords and warlords. And since any government is better than no government at all, democratic government must, out of necessity, at times cooperate with other non-democratic governments. Ultimately, however, all governments must be changed according to the American ideal, because only democracy allows for peaceful change and continuous progress. Democratic governments, such as the United States and its European allies, are inherently peaceful and do not wage war against each other. If they must wage war at all, their wars are always wars of defense against aggressive non-democratic regimes. That is, they are just wars. Thus, all countries and territories that are currently occupied by American troops or those of its European allies have been guilty of aggression by definition. And their occupation by foreign troops is an act of self-defense and of liberation on the part of the democratic West. The aggressiveness of the Islamic world in particular is proven by the very fact that large parts of it are under American Western occupation, and more areas still are provoking such liberating occupation. Democratic governments are of the people, by the people, and for the people. In democracy, no one rules over anyone, but the people rule themselves and are hence free. Taxes are contributions and payments for services rendered by government, and tax evaders are accordingly thieves who take without pay, and harboring fugitive thieves is then again an act of aggression against the people from whom they flee. private property, markets, and profit-making are good and useful institutions, but democratic government must see to it through proper legislation that private property and profits are acquired and used in a socially responsible way, and that markets function efficiently. Moreover, markets and profit-motivated business cannot produce public goods and thus satisfy social needs, and they cannot take care of the truly needy. Social needs and the needy can be taken care of only by government. Government alone, through the funding of public goods and support given to the needy, can enhance the public good, the public welfare, and reduce, if not entirely eliminate, neediness and the number of the needy. In particular, government social policy must control the private vice of greed and profiteering. Greed and profiteering were also the root cause of the present economic crisis. Reckless financiers created an irrational exuberance in the public that has finally founded on reality. The market manifestly failed, and only government stood ready to save the situation. And only government, through proper regulation and supervision of the banking industry and financial markets, can prevent anything like this from ever happening again. Banks and businesses went bankrupt, but government and their central banks stood tall and protected savers' money and workers' jobs. Advised now by the best and best paid economists in the world, governments have discovered the cause of the crisis and determined that to get out of the current economic mess, people must both consume more and invest more. Every penny, however, hoarded under the mattress is a penny withheld from present consumption and investment, and so it diminishes future consumption and investment. In a recession, under all circumstances, and above all, spending must be increased. And if the people do not spend enough of their money, then government must do it for them with its money. Wisely, governments are equipped to do so because their central banks can produce all necessary liquidity. If billions of dollars or euros will not do it, trillions will. And if trillions will fail to do the trick, then quadrillions surely will. Only massive government spending can avert an otherwise unavoidable economic meltdown. Unemployment, in particular, is a result of underconsumption, of people not having enough money to buy consumer goods, and it must be cured by giving them higher money wages or higher unemployment benefits. And once the current economic crisis has been solved, governments can and must again turn to the truly pressing among the remaining problems confronting mankind: the elimination of all unfair discrimination as the ultimate desideratum of democratic egalitarianism, and the control of the global environment, and in particular, the world climate. Essentially, all humans are equal. Differences are only apparent and skin deep and insignificant. Some people are white, some brown, and some black. Some are tall and others are short. Some have penises and others have vaginas. Some speak English and others Polish or Chinese. Some have cancer and others don't. But these are all accidental human characteristics. Some people happen to have them and others not. However, from such accidental differences, only trivial consequences follow, such that the tall can reach higher up, that blacks can better hide in the dark, that only women can bear children, or that some people will die sooner than others. But accidental differences such as these have no systematic bearing on mental traits such as motivational energy, time preference, or intellectual prowess, and as such, they are without explanatory power concerning economic and social success, in particular, income, professional status, and position. Mental traits have no physical or biological or ethnic basis and are infinitely malleable. Everyone, except for a few pathological cases, is like everyone else in this regard, and every people throughout history have made an equal contribution to civilization. Seemingly apparent differences are solely the result of different external circumstances and training opportunities. If properly situated and trained, everyone is capable of the same achievements. All income and achievement differences between whites and Asians and blacks, between women and men, Latinos, Anglos and Thais, and Hindus, Protestants and Muslims would vanish and disappear. Whites would be brought up, could be brought up to compete on a par with blacks for the highest prizes in the NBA, in the 100 meter sprint, and in long distance running, and blacks could compete with whites and Asians in mass, chess, and engineering. If it is found instead that the representation and distribution of various accidental groups in various social positions and income, wealth, and professional status is unequal, then this shows unjustified discrimination, and such discrimination must be rectified by appropriate affirmative action programs by which the discriminators must compensate the unjustly discriminated. There is just one possible exception from this general principle of human equality and the evil of discrimination. Because beyond any reasonable doubt, there was one crime in history committed by one particular people against one particular other people that is the greatest and most atrocious crime of all times. It cannot be ruled out that this uniquely criminal disposition on the part of one people and this unique victim status of one other people has genetic roots. And insofar as this possibility cannot be ruled out, it is only fair that the collectively guilty must continue to compensate the collective victims, and everyone else must give this one victim group its special due and discriminating respect. Hand in hand with the efforts to eradicate the evil of discrimination, democratic government must tackle the fundamental task of overcoming the excessive human particularism, the individualism, the localism, the provincialism, the regionalism, the nationalism, which is still ingrained in the minds of most people, and promote instead the ideal of universalism and of the universal man and the interests of humanity as such. The necessity of this policy is demonstrated most dramatically by the dangers of global climate change. As a result of countless selfish acts, the unregulated production and consumption of various non-renewable sources of energy, the whole globe is threatened by unimaginable catastrophes of tidal waves, sharply and suddenly rising sea levels, and the emergence of momentous ecological imbalances and instabilities. Only through worldwide concerted government action and ultimately the establishment of some supranational world government and through minute, scientifically validated and worldwide administered and enforced behavioral regulations of all production and consumption activities can these life-threatening dangers be averted. Gemeinwohl geht vor Eigenwohl is how the Nazis framed it. In English, public welfare comes before private welfare. And this, above all, is what the problem of climate change demonstrates, and it is up to government to finally put this principle into action. The Property and Freedom Society, and most certainly I personally, consider all of this that I have just told you as utter nonsense, as just crazy, and then dangerous nonsense as that. Yet this is essentially what we can hear and read day in and day out in the mainstream media and what is proclaimed by every respectable expert and eminence. Only few people can see through the entire charade, and even less have the courage to speak up against it. It is the purpose of the Property and Freedom Society and its meetings to assemble such people to frontally attack at this entire craziness and the ruling class that perpetrates it on us, and to have fun doing it, at least while we are still permitted to have fun. So is this.